Good afternoon to you. We are now continuing with the Constitution. Parliamentary committees. In the parliamentary committees, we have completed Finance Committee, which consisted of Public Accounts Committee, Estimate Committee, and Committee on Public Undertakings. All the these three committees are elected committees and dealing with finance. PAC exclusively for opposition MP and Estimate Committee exclusively for ruling party, and Public Undertaking Committee is also for ruling party. Today we are taking up departmentally related parliamentary standing committee, DRSC. Normally we call this as DRSC, that is Departmentally Related Standing Committee of Parliament. Before going into the details of these committees, we should understand the rationale behind the setting up of these committees. What is the rationale? Why these committees were set up? Why these committees were found necessary? All these things we will see now. See, remember, Lok Sabha is the watchdog of public finance. It is the watchdog of public finance. Under the Constitution of India, the executive, that is the Council of Ministers, that is the government, cannot withdraw even a single pie from the Consolidated Fund of India without the express approval of Lok Sabha. Why? Why this provision has been made? Because all the expenditure incurred by the executive, as well as legislature, as well as judiciary, and all the taxes are collected from people. See, the taxes are collected from the people of the country, and these funds are spent by the executive, spent by the legislature, spent by the judiciary. It is our money. It is people's money. So, when you want to collect money, when you want to spend money, from the money so collected, you should have the approval of the representatives of the people. All the 130 crore people cannot give you an yes or no. So we have formed a representative democracy, and Lok Sabha represents the will of the people. So it means that any expenditure incurred from Consolidated Fund of India should have the approval of Lok Sabha. Remember. Similarly, any amount collected from the people of the country should have the approval of Lok Sabha. No tax can be imposed without the authority of law. Who makes the law? Parliament. So you cannot collect money from the people through tax without the approval of Lok Sabha. Similarly, you cannot spend even a single pie from the Consolidated Fund of India without the approval of Lok Sabha. This is the two things behind the representative democracy. Now, how do you ensure this? How you can ensure that the money spent by the executive, that is the government, has the approval of Lok Sabha? We have a budget, technically called annual financial statement. In which article? Article 112 of the Constitution. So, if the money has been sanctioned in the budget, which is passed by the legislature, parliament, that means the people of India has given the approval for withdrawal of said money from the Consolidated Fund of India. Now, this is the rationale. Now, prior to 1993, 31st March 1993, 1993. What was happening was, you know, we had around 45 ministries. It is not possible for the Lok Sabha to examine the demands for grants. Demands for grants is nothing but the demand. If it is approved by Lok Sabha, it becomes grant. It is the asking the money from the Lok Sabha. That is the meaning of demands for grant. You are demanding for the grants, and when it is sanctioned, the demand becomes a grant. That is why the technically it is called demand for grants. So the demands for grants of all the ministries are expected to be checked, scrutinized, examined by the Lok Sabha. 45 ministries were there. Let us say at that time, to my knowledge, it was around 39 ministries. Now, it was not possible for Lok Sabha to scrutinize all the demands for grants of all the ministries. It is not possible. It is not humanly possible. Every demand for, you know, normally one ministry will have one for administrative and one for technical. So it may be having a 27 to 28 demands will be there. All the 27 demands in each ministry means how many ministries are there? 39 ministries. All the demands will be examined by the Lok Sabha. Is it possible humanly? No, it is not possible. So what was done was, you know, they will choose 3 to 4 ministries. The Lok Sabha Secretariat will choose 3 to 4 ministries, take the approval of the speaker. In those 3 ministries, demands for grants will be examined in detail. In detail. Threadbare discussion. Now, during the discussion of these 3 to 4 ministries selected at random, threadbare discussion will be there, including moving of cut motions. I have already told you what is cut motion. 3 kinds of cut motions. One is policy cut and economic cut and token cut. And I also told you, if the policy cut motion is passed, the Council of Ministers is obliged to resign as per the Supreme Court decision. So, these 3 cut motions can be sponsored by the members of parliament, and it will be taken for discussion in respect of these 3 ministries only. These 3 to 4 ministries. Now, what will happen to the rest of the demands for grants of the rest of the ministries? Rest of the ministries' demands for grants will be summarily voted. What is called guillotine. So, all the outstanding demands will be put to vote, what is technically called guillotine, and the demands for grant of rest of the ministries are taken as passed by Lok Sabha. See, rest of the ministries' demands for grants will be taken as passed by the Lok Sabha, even though they have not been discussed. Imagine the situation. We call ourselves as the most democratic nation. And one side we say our Lok Sabha is the custodian of the Consolidated Fund of India. But here is the case where thousands of crores of rupees are withdrawn from Consolidated Fund of India without scrutiny, without examination, without even going through. This was the situation. No doubt, there were three committees were there, Science and Technology, Environment, Forest and Agriculture. These 3 committees were subsequently, prior to 1993, I think it is 1989, it was set up. But not all ministries. So to overcome this aberration of democracy, I call this as aberration of democracy, to overcome this state of lack of review by the legislature of the executive expenditure, the departmentally related parliamentary standing committees were established. When? In 1993, that is 1993, 31st March 1993, it was established. Initially, there were only 17 committees. Initially, there were only 17 committees, of which 11 were under Lok Sabha and 6 were under Rajya Sabha. After experiencing the working of the departmentally related parliamentary standing committee over a decade, the system was restructured. Remember, restructured in July 2004. Now, PT point of view, come back. 31st March 1993, departmentally related parliamentary standing committees set up, Narasimha Rao government, and then all the ministries have been covered. Initially, how many committees were there? 17 committees, of which 11 were under Lok Sabha, 6 were under Rajya Sabha. Then this was restructured in 2004, under which the number of standing committees increased from 17 to 24. 17 to 24. Of the 24 committees, 16 are under Lok Sabha, 8 are under Rajya Sabha. What do you mean by under Lok Sabha, under Rajya Sabha? It is under the administrative control of Lok Sabha, 16. Under the administrative control of Rajya Sabha, 8. Now, each committee has 31 members. How many members? Each committee has 31 members. 21 from Lok Sabha and 10 from Rajya Sabha. 21 from Lok Sabha, 10 from Rajya Sabha. Seats of each committee are allotted to different parties and groups in proportion to their respective strength in the house. Naturally, the highest number of seats are there with the ruling party. Their members will get the more number of seats in the standing committee. Suitable numbers of seats were allotted to the independent and unattached members also. In other words, all members of Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha, except ministers, remember, except ministers, have been nominated in one or other committees. So you understood the rationale, I think. It is more important from the PT point of view, July 2004, restructuring. Now how much? 24 committees, 18 under Lok Sabha, 16 under Lok Sabha, 8 are under Rajya Sabha. Each committee has 31 members, 21 plus 10. So this is the allocation. The chairman of 8 standing committees allocated to Rajya Sabha are appointed by chairman Rajya Sabha. Who appoints the chairman? Among the members of the standing committee, chairman will be appointed by chairman Rajya Sabha in respect of 8 standing committees, which are under the administrative control of Rajya Sabha. The chairman of other 16 committees are appointed by the speaker among the members of the committee. By speaker, remember. Now, most importantly, a minister cannot be a member of the committee, obviously. The report is against the government. How minister can be the member? Now, the term of the member is 1 year from the date of constitution of the committee. Now, the normal procedure is, after general discussion on the budget in the house is completed, both the houses are adjourned for recess. How much period recess? 4 weeks. During this recess period, the committees will consider the demands for grants of the concerned ministries and submit their report to the speaker. There is a separate report on the demands for grants of each ministry. In addition to demands for grants, committee will consider the bills introduced in both the houses of parliament and the annual reports, other long-term policy documents. All the three will be can be considered by the standing committee. The reports of the standing committee is only of persuasive value. No doubt, it exerts great influence, but it has only persuasive value. And it is only an advice, not binding on the government. As per the directions given by the speaker, that is, I think, Mr. Somnath Chatterjee, the minister concerned should make a half-yearly statement in the House regarding the status of implementation of the recommendations contained in the report of the Standing Committee by the Ministry. Normally, the reports are adopted by consensus among the members. However, a member can give the dissent note also, and it is presented to the House along with the report. So, you understood the background. So, PT point of view, I have already told you. Now, for mains point of view, final exam, that is civil service final, mains. If there is an essay question or if there is an important part about parliamentary committee, 15 marks, then you should write these points. What are the deficiencies, gray area? What are the handicaps? What is the lacuna in the system? I have already told you, never think that we are more intelligent than the person, than the dignitaries who established the institution. No, we are only trying to improve. We are only teaching ourselves. We are all students. To that extent, understand. What is lacking here? There are too many committees. Nearly 20 House committees, 24 standing committees, around 28 to 30 consultative committee, and many select committees, many joint committees, many ad hoc committees. Many of the functions of the committees are overlapping. So, the common sense dictates that there is a need to streamline the functions of the committee, number one. Number two, with the proliferation of committees, in many cases, even rooms are not available. With the standing committees in position, the need for consultative committee should be reconsidered. What is the need for the consultative committee originally? Pandit Nehru thought that all our members of parliament are new. They do not know about the functioning of the secretariat. They do not know about the policy formulation. So, we should train. That is why it is called a consultative committee. So, all the members of the parliament were associated in the consultative committee so that they get acquaintance with the functioning of the government. That is the reason. Now, they after 1950, today it is 2020. So, why to keep all the committees? So, one of the suggestions made by the dignitaries are, you reconsider the need for consultative committee. Next, every committee can appoint a subcommittee. There is a provision. Every committee can appoint a study group. There is a provision to look into a particular problem. Each such subcommittee or study group presupposes meeting rooms, hospitality expenditure, stenographic assistance, etc. That means, again draining the exchequer. So, number four. Number five, the recommendations of the standing committee are only recommendatory and not binding on the government. On the basis of the standing committee recommendations, hardly any demand has been changed. Besides, there is no set procedure to implement the committee's recommendations. Only half-yearly implementation report is only submitted. There is no discussion on it. In fact, if there is no quorum or if there is no time positive, because of paucity of time, many of the cases, it is only laid on the table in the House and sent to the secretariat. No discussion takes place. So, reconsider. Secondly, the committee suggestions are not given serious thought by the ministry. Why? Because there are too many committees. I have already told you. Secretary or other officers will be grumbling to come to the committee because there are too many committees. Every week one committee means the secretary has to make arrangement for the joint secretary. He has to take up the joint secretary's help. He has to take the agencies. So, it is a nightmare for the secretary, for the departments. Number one, the ministry could not make any changes even with the committee's suggestions are serious. No time. They have to, the budget is presented on 1st February and 3 or 4 days, then 4 weeks, 1st March. The very that time you have to pass the budget, guillotine will be normally by the April 1st week. Very that time. There is no time. The another thing is, the quorum for Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha is 1/10. How much? 1/10. The quorum for committee, 1/3. There are 24 committees with 31 members each. When the parliament is in session, quorum is not possible. Quorum in the committee is not possible. During the recess period of 1 month, normally the members will go back to their constituency because their blood is buttered in their constituency. They cannot forsake the interest of the constituency and spend the time for committee meetings. So, again, work of the committee suffers. Then, since the standing committee comprise the representatives of different political parties, normally the issues are decided mostly on party lines. If a particular political party has taken a decision, the members of the committee cannot take a different decision. Suppose if the particular policy is or particular grants is there against the government, the normally ruling party will not accept. Because you know, whether whip may not be issued, but there is an lurking fear in the minds of the party member that their party is supervising, seeing, that is, Big Brother is watching. So they will not take, unlike UK. In UK, there no whip can be issued for the committee meetings. They can, any member can express any opinion except the 2 or 3 items. They cannot, there is no whip possible for a committee meeting. But such a position is not there in India. Even if the issue is genuine, true and serious, the discussion normally goes only on the party lines. This is another handicap. So keeping all these things, it may be necessary, it may be prudent, it may be desirable to overhaul the committee system. With this, we will end the class. We will take up the other house committees in the next class. Thank you. Thank you.